Hello, wonderful person, this is Anton, and this right here is the most incredible image ever produced by the Hubble telescope, or potentially just in general by anything. Today we're going to discuss what exactly this image is, what it represents, and why it's so absolutely mind-blowing. And in order for us to start this story, we're going to start with this. This is the Lego model of the Hubble telescope, the most impressive telescope ever constructed by human beings, spearheaded and designed by this wonderful lady right here, Nancy J. Roman. This is actually from the Lego set I bought a few months ago, and I even made a video about it. You can check it out right above my head if you'd like to get a copy of this as well. But today we're going to be talking about the image that was recently reconstructed using Hubble data, and the image that is just so mind-blowing that, well, it actually crashed my computer when I tried to open it. So first of all, our story begins back in 1995, when scientists decided to see how much they could push Hubble, and they decided to just stare at the same spot for about 10 days and record all of the data. And then all of this data was reconstructed in a single image known as the Hubble Deep Field. This image was the epithet of Hubble's possibilities and Hubble's potentials of seeing far, far away. It was essentially an image that showed us very, 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 very dark time back billions of years ago, and it was a look into the universe's history. But scientists were not satisfied with that just yet. They decided to push it further. And so for many decades, for many years, we kept pushing it more and more, looking at different locations and discovering new and new things with this incredible telescope. But this was in 1995, and since then, over 20 years have passed, and we've collected a lot of data from Hubble. And this is when the scientists decided to create something new. They decided to combine all of this data from various decades and focus on just one spot in the skies. They have then picked a location in the skies that was approximately same size as the full moon, and combined all of the data, including ultraviolet data, infrared, X-ray data, into a single image made out of approximately 7,500 different exposures, representative of 31 different Hubble programs that were initiated over the period of about 16 years. And overall, this whole image was almost as if we looked at the same spot for about 8 months. And what the scientists were able to produce is pretty mind-blowing, actually. So you can find the image itself in the description below, and let me warn you, it's really, really big. It's so big, as a matter of fact, that, like I said, it crashed my computer. The image that they refer to as the Hubble Legacy Field, as you can see, comes in different sizes, but the actual original image is approximately 25,000 pixels by 25,000 pixels, and it's equivalent to about 672 megabytes, or if you want it even higher resolution, it's approximately 1 gigabyte, all in one single file. Now, I was actually able to open this with GIMP, which is the free software you can use to edit images. And overall, this is kind of what I got. So here, this image contains over 250,000 different galaxies. You may not see all of them until you start zooming in. And what's really interesting here is that all of this here represents history. This is literally like looking back in time billions and billions of years ago, even though it's a single image. Now, it may not look that way. As a matter of fact, it might not even make sense at first, until you really zoom in and start looking at these tiny, tiny spots, each of which, each single light spot, representing a huge galaxy, very similar to our own Milky Way that you see right here. And every single one of these galaxies contains trillions, or at least billions, hundreds of billions of different stars. Now, this is actually really mind-blowing when you think about it, because all of this is, of course, real. This is not an image that was simulated or generated. All of this is reality, and this is literally in just a tiny, tiny spot of the night skies. That single moon-sized night spot produced over 260,000 different galaxies that you can go and check out by yourself in the link that I provided. But I think this summary right here really makes it much clearer. So let me show you what all of this represents. This image here shows you various galaxies that are in this image and their age, and also, of course, the age of the universe when these galaxies sent the light to us that we were then able to capture. So for example, this right here is only about 500 million years after the creation of the universe, and you can see this redshifted galaxy right here that's ridiculously far, but also super old. Then a few hundred million years later, this is what we get, then we get this, and so on, with some of the more recent galaxies right here. And so this actually shows you how that single image is literally just all of the times in history, all in the same spot, and it's literally like looking back in time, but you get all of this at the same time. And I really love how effective this particular image is in trying to explain what is really happening right here and how all of this shows you basically the history of time. Now, so far, this is the most accurate and the most detailed image ever produced by anything, and it literally shows us the transformation of the universe through time. And this is super cool because all of the effects we expect those galaxies to have, they actually do have. So like, for example, this is in Space Engine, of course. Those are the little spots that we see. Those are also galaxies. And if we kind of use our telescope here to zoom in, you'll see that eventually, at a certain distance, the galaxies start turning more yellow and then eventually more red. This is what we call the redshift. So this galaxy here is probably really far away. And this is the redshift effect that it gets from moving really fast away from us due to the expansion of the universe itself, due to the stretching of space. Likewise, if I were to zoom in here in this super high quality image and take a look at some of the farther galaxies, you'll notice that just like in the simulation, we have quite a lot of galaxies that are redshifted, which becomes very obvious and very easy to see. And this by itself is pretty much a given proof to us that the universe is expanding, and it's expanding really fast. And the farther the galaxy is from us, the more redshifted it is. Now, I haven't really found anything super redshifted. Like, there's one here that's kind of red-ish. There's a few more galaxies that you can obviously see that they're redshifted. But what I was personally doing with this image is actually trying to find something that is even more interesting, like, for example, galactic collisions. There's definitely a lot of really cool things to look for here, especially if your computer is powerful enough and if you can zoom in even closer. But just the fact that this image even exists is already mind-blowing. Remember, this is not a simulation, this is not a recreation, this is literally a picture of someone looking at the same spot in the skies for a pretty long time, with a really long exposure, without any atmospheric effects, because Hubble is actually in space. And until future telescopes come out, this is going to be the best image of the universe we have. As a matter of fact, it's probably going to stay the record holder for at least a few years. And even though the future telescope will actually most likely take an even better picture of the universe, for now, this is probably the best one we have. Which also means that this is literally the best picture of the universe we have as of 2019. Hello, wonderful person, and welcome to the center of our own galaxy, Sagittarius A star. In today's video, we're going to be talking about a new discovery of something else very mysterious and very strange happening here in the center, and the discovery of what seems to be one of the largest structures in the galaxy. So when it comes to talking about structures in the galaxy, I think for the most part, most people believe that the galaxy sort of looks like this. And this would have been true possibly, I guess, a decade or so ago, maybe a little bit longer. But since then, we started to discovering a lot of new things and a lot of new formations that make this image too simple and very incomplete to what the galaxy really looks like. A few years ago, I tried to create the more realistic representation, but even that was incomplete back then and is definitely incomplete now, because we know that there are a lot of other structures here that are just a little bit more difficult to see. Like, for example, our galaxy has the so-called galactic streams that we've been discovering pretty much every year now. There are quite a lot of them that have already been discovered, and these represent the leftovers from various smaller galaxies that the Milky Way has absorbed, but left pieces of those galaxies sort of orbiting around. We also have the recently discovered Fermi bubbles that we found back in 2010, and we still have no idea what they are, but these are extremely large structures, sort of looking like bubbles, I guess, on both sides of the Milky Way. There's a lot of very powerful radiation emanating from there, including gamma rays, and in one of the previous videos, I even suggested that there might be a chance that what we're looking at is interaction of dark matter, but we know so little about these bubbles and we understand them so little that it will probably take us a few years before we finally know what's really happening here. And just now, very recently, another scientific team discovered something else unusual close to the center of the galaxy, the unusual radio bubbles that you're looking at right here. Now, it's kind of difficult to actually understand what's happening, but the middle of the galaxy is right there, and there are these very large formations around it that sort of resemble bubbles. This is something that the scientist, the primary scientist behind this paper that you can find in the description below, has been studying since the 80s, basically for like, what, 30 years now, 40 years? And back then, he only discovered some parts of it. He discovered these unusual formations that he referred to as filaments that were magnetized. They had very large length, several light years across, and they seem to have unusual structure, origin, and, well, magnetism. He couldn't really explain them back then, and actually even today we still don't really know what they are. But what he realized over the years is that a lot of these filaments were actually inside of these larger structures. And these structures seem to contain several hundred of them, all in a sense kind of connected together with this unusual and very, I guess in some sense, beautiful radio structure that we don't have a name for yet, but right now we're calling them radio bubbles. Mostly because it's only really visible in radio waves and they do resemble bubbles in some way. Here's what the map of all of this kind of looks like. You can see the black hole is right here, this is Sagittarius A star, and the bubbles, I mean, they're not really bubble looking, but they do look like some sort of leftovers from something really major. And all this probably connects to Sagittarius A star as well. And by the way, the distance here is roughly around 13 to maybe 1400 light years. Now, that's a pretty large distance. Just to give you a comparison, the distance from planet Earth, which is somewhere right here in this arm, to the center of the galaxy is about 25,000 light years. And so that would be maybe 1/15th of the distance. So these bubbles are not really that big when it comes to the galactic size, but they are big enough when it comes to more human size, or even when it comes to just looking at various stars. In other words, if I were to try to help you visualize this here in Space Engine, I would have to fly at the speed of light for roughly around 1400 years, and I'm going to try to show you what all of this looks like in the simulation. So here we're only about 10 light years away. We have to go for a very long time away from the center before we can reach the limit of the size of these bubbles. And I think we're about 1/5 of the way there, and roughly around here, I think, yeah, this is about 1200, 1300, 1400. So this is the distance to those unusual bubbles from the center of the galaxy. As you can imagine, these objects are really large, which is why we're technically considering them to be one of the largest objects in the galaxy. Simply because they do seem to be connected to each other and they do seem to have an interaction of some sort. But we obviously don't really know what they are. The one explanation and suggestion so far is of course related to the black hole, and in some sense, well, let me explain it to you this way. Here's a geyser, and after a geyser erupts, it sort of leaves these heated up water droplets that do produce mist that stays in the vicinity for quite a long time. And normally there's quite a lot of energy released in a geyser eruption, and this kind of maybe parallels what happened back then, millions of years ago, in the center of our galaxy. In other words, it's quite possible that the supermassive black hole increased its luminosity and its eruptions, and the size of the astrophysical jets increased to the point where it was very likely emitting a lot of energy. It might have even become a temporary quasar in a sense. Now, not an actual quasar that is so powerful that you can see it from really far away, but a black hole that you could sort of consider an AGN, an active galactic nuclei galaxy. In other words, these astrophysical jets increased in power so much that the emissions generated a lot of energy and spread out a lot of material for many, many light years close to the black hole. And it's very possible that, similarly to a geyser, this is how these radio bubbles were formed as well. So basically what we're looking at is kind of a signal or an indication, or really just the leftovers from a very large emission coming from both sides of the black hole, which is of course how we theoretically predict these jets to behave anyway. And these emissions left all of this material behind that is still very energized, very polarized, extremely magnetic, and emits quite a lot of radio waves even today. And when this happened is of course another question, and maybe by studying these bubbles we'll figure it out one day. But for now the assumption is that it might have happened a few million years ago, and it very likely made the black hole extremely overbearingly bright. So bright, as a matter of fact, that it was probably a typical star in the night skies, maybe even brighter. And we don't really know if this radiation in any way affected the life on Earth, but if the jets were pointing at our planet, which is actually very unlikely, but if they were, in that case, it might have actually caused another extinction. But we know that a few million years ago, there was no major extinction event, so it's very unlikely that any of this affected the life on Earth. Nevertheless though, these events are very powerful and they can totally affect life on Earth, which is why it's important for us to study what happens when our black hole suddenly becomes really bright. Now, we don't know why it happened. It's very likely that possibly some sort of a planet or a star got swallowed by the black hole and gave it enough fuel to create these emissions. But all of this is of course a speculation right now, because the only thing we know for a fact is that there are these radio waves that we've detected. They seem to be leftovers from something really major that occurred millions of years ago, but their origin could still really be from anything. For all we know, maybe this is a sign of a completely different phenomenon we just don't understand yet. And we've just discovered this and confirmed this only a few days ago from when I'm making this video, so it will probably take a few years before we can pinpoint the true origin of these objects, and possibly even longer. And one of the reasons why we haven't really seen it until now is actually because if you were to look at this region, most of it is dominated by Sagittarius A itself, by the black hole. It's such a bright object and it's so extremely powerful that it sort of hides a lot of other things nearby. So it's a little bit difficult to see things here, even with a powerful enough telescope. And what's really unusual is that, by other standards, our black hole is considered to be really quiet. This is actually what a quiet region looks like. So you can imagine what a non-quiet or active galactic nuclei would look like. It would be so strong in all sorts of transmissions that, like I said before, it might actually affect life in very bad ways. But there are also a few things we've learned by looking at these radio bubbles. For one, we've learned approximately how much energy was released during this event, and it's equivalent to about 70 foes. Fo is actually a measurement unit used for supernova. Normally, one supernova releases around one fo, which is equivalent to 10 to the power of 51 ergs. So this event released something equivalent to about 70 supernova. And just to give you another comparison, our Sun, over its whole lifetime, is going to release about 1/50th of that energy. And so essentially it's equivalent to our Sun shining for 10 billion years and then doing so about 60 times. This is how much energy this event released. And the other discovery is of course related to the filaments themselves, which suggests that all of these radio filaments, magnetic filaments, and all of these other unusual energized events happening in this region are all connected. There is definitely a connection between them, and it's quite observable, and doesn't just suggest that they all came from the same event, it also suggests that they keep continuously interacting with each other for millions of years to come, producing quite a lot of energy even afterwards. And although on the one hand it would be nice for scientific reasons to actually witness such event and possibly study it in a little bit more detail, on the other hand, a lot of scientists also believe that we might not really survive such an event. It's very likely that the amount of energy such event produces might potentially create a lot of problems here on Earth, decreasing the amount of ozone layer in our atmosphere and essentially turning our planet a little bit more dangerous to live on. Okay, maybe not this dangerous, not boiling Earth dangerous, but still dangerous enough for life to change its direction in some way or another. In other words, these powerful events coming from supermassive black holes in the middle might actually cause extinction events that could definitely change the history of the planet. Hello, wonderful person, this is Anton, and imagine for a second that something really massive passed through our galaxy. How do you think we would be able to see it, especially if it's something as invisible or hard to see as a supermassive black hole like the one right here? And so now that it's passed through our galaxy, we should be able to observe something, like for example, this hole right there might have been caused by the passage of this black hole. And so today we're going to discuss a study that was just recently released that suggests that something really massive did shoot through the Milky Way, and we've observed the effects of this unusual passage. Okay, so in this case, it's actually kind of difficult to really see the effects because the masses involved and also the amount of stars involved is quite high. But the scientist behind this particular paper, whose name is Anna Bunaka and who presented her work and whose actual PowerPoint presentation you can find in the description below, talks just about that. It seems that there are signs that something really, really massive, and we're talking about a mass of about million masses of the sun, very close to a typical supermassive black hole, passed through the Milky Way. Now, okay, let's talk a little bit more about how all of this was discovered and also what all of this suggests. So first of all, the scientist behind this paper was looking at what's known as the stellar streams. You may have known already that our galaxy is surrounded by these unusual, almost like ring formations. And these are stellar streams that were created by the tidal disruptions, or essentially gravitational disruption, of our own galaxy, of various objects like, for example, dwarf galaxies or all kinds of globular clusters that passed too close to the gravitational source. In other words, think of them as rings of Saturn, but in galactic terms. One of the most recently discovered streams is this right here. This is the Fimbulto stream, named after the Norse river Fimbulto. And it's composed of about 310 different stars. And as you can see, it forms this really, really cool looking stream connected to a globular cluster named Omega Centauri. And this was discovered only a few months ago from when I'm making this video. So we've discovered quite a lot of these unusual streams, and many of them can only be seen from either northern or southern hemisphere. The one that we're interested in is this one right here, GD1 stream. This was discovered back in 2006. Just like the other streams, it's sort of created by something really ancient, most likely a dwarf galaxy, but we're not really sure. And it contains a lot of really ancient stars that are very, very poor in metal, very typical of an ancient dwarf galaxy or an ancient globular cluster. And then it passed very close to our galaxy and got stretched into this really long stream. It's a little bit difficult to see it, but it's there. And when Anna was studying this particular stream, she simulated the model of the stream. This is kind of what it should look like, but then realized that it looked different from what we were supposed to be seeing. In other words, something was not really adding up. There are these unusual star formations that were sticking out as if something punched through them. And all of this data that was collected by the Gaia telescope was actually really accurate. So something was happening here, and she was trying to explain what. She then created another simulation where something did perturb the stream, and it looked like this. And as you can see, it sort of resembles what we're seeing. And specifically here, the perturbation happened approximately 495 million years ago. The mass of this object was about 5 million masses of the sun, and it was about 10 parsec, or approximately 33 light years in radius, and moved at about 250 kilometers per second. In other words, we're talking about something very similar to Sagittarius A star, the supermassive black hole in the middle of our own galaxy. And that something, if it passed through this area, would create what we're observing. Here's another look at the data, and as you can see, there are these unusual gaps in the actual stream that are difficult to explain without something massive causing them. So kind of like a supermassive black hole, or maybe a very, very large and very massive chunk of dark matter. So this is where the mystery begins, because we have no idea what caused this. If this was a supermassive black hole, practically equivalent in mass and in size to Sagittarius A-star that you see right here, it should be creating a lot of energy, a lot of emissions, and a lot of various types of electromagnetic radiation that we should be seeing from everywhere. In other words, if our galaxy had another supermassive black hole, which would be kind of unusual, we should be able to see it, right? Because if it passed through those stars, at least a few of those stars may have been captured or destroyed in the process, so the radiation should be visible. But unfortunately, when we look into the night skies, where this object passed or the location where it may have been, there's nothing. No radiation is detected, no supermassive black hole, nothing that would suggest that a very large, very powerful object was creating any kind of energy. So this leaves us with another mystery. So maybe it could have been another proof of dark matter. Maybe this was a very massive, very large collection of dark matter particles that moved through this area and generated the disturbances that we observe. But right now, this is just a speculation. There's absolutely no proof of this being dark matter. It's probably just one of the better explanations, though. However, it could also be something else. It could also be something like this. Something like a typical globular cluster that was very massive, approximately 5 million masses of the Sun, and by passing through this area, it then slowly fell apart. So maybe it got destroyed or turned into another stellar stream that we haven't detected yet. So it's very possible that this was just a collision between our galaxy and yet another globular cluster. But once again, there's no visual proof just yet. Even though we've looked at those areas quite thoroughly, okay, not that thoroughly, but we've looked a lot, we haven't really seen any proof of this happening. So if it was some sort of a globular cluster, or if it was some sort of a black hole, there's just no visual proof whatsoever yet. But because Anna was the first to discover this, there's definitely going to be follow-up studies that might discover what's really happening in this particular region and what really caused this unusual disturbance in the GD1 stream. Now, in the future, we might discover even more proof or more collisions that have occurred, but this one is very mysterious because 5 million masses of the Sun is a lot. This is basically, like I said, a supermassive black hole sized object. And if it's a rogue black hole from another galaxy, that would be a tremendous discovery. So for all we know, in the next few months and possibly in the next few years, we'll actually discover what really happened here. For now though, it's yet another mystery we're going to add to the list of mysteries that are yet to be solved, just like the dark matter itself. Hello wonderful person, this is Anton, and in this video we're going to be briefly talking about the history of our own galaxy, the Milky Way, and more specifically about a very interesting event that happened about a billion years ago that created a lot of stars very suddenly. So when it comes to the star formation in our galaxy, for the longest time scientists always believed that this was something that may have happened over billions and billions of years, and it was a very gradual process. Some stars formed, others got destroyed. Some stars formed again from the material that was released, and so on and so forth. I mean, this is kind of how we believe the Sun was created as well. After about hundreds or so of different generations of stars, finally our Sun was born as well. But when it comes to star generation and specifically star formation, it's not really as clear-cut as we've always believed. The study that I'm going to be talking about in this video, that you can find in the description below, investigated the formation of stars deep in the center of our galaxy, specifically the central region, the so-called nuclear disk, which actually refers to this large area that's roughly around 400 or so light years across. And this nuclear disk obviously has a lot of stars in the middle, but studying them and trying to learn more about them allows us to really kind of see back into the history of our galaxy, because many stars in this disk are relatively ancient. At the same time, the central disk, or the nuclear disk, is also a region of very, very active star formation. And even in this image here, you can kind of tell that there are a lot more stars in the center than there are here on the outskirts in the galactic arms. And so what exactly did the scientists behind this paper discover? And also how did they discover it? Well, the how part is, I guess, relatively easy to explain. They looked at the stars and the actual color and temperature of most of these stars in the region, and they were able to find out their age and study when they were formed. In other words, they were able to distribute these stars in terms of the actual age of formation, and they were also able to see how many stars were present from each of the generation of various star formations. And so what they've discovered is that for the most part, most of these stars in our galaxy were created pretty long time ago, at least 8 billion years ago, and this is kind of true for most of these stars in the central region. So most stars are actually pretty ancient in our galaxy, suggesting of course that Milky Way overall is a really old galaxy. But at the same time, they also discovered that the star formation is not really a sort of a prolonged process. It happens and then it stops. It happens again and then it stops again. So in other words, the star formation happens in these really large bursts. And in between these bursts of star formation, there are these really long periods of quiet time, when only very, very, very few stars are formed around the galaxy, and it just so happens that we're now in that quiet time where barely any stars are being made at all. And so if about 80% of all of the stars in our galaxy were formed anywhere between 8 to 13 billion years ago, that also means that our Sun, which was only formed about 5 billion years ago, is actually one of the younger and one of the more rare members of our galaxy. There are probably a lot less stars like our Sun in our galaxy compared to basically the majority of stuff that we can find here. And also this study suggests that our Sun was probably created during the quiet period of our galaxy. In other words, it was one of those stars that formed very, very slowly from the material that was left from other supernova. And if the majority of stars in the center of our galaxy were formed in bursts, then, well, I guess the next question is, when was the last such burst? Did such an event occur relatively recently, or is this something that hasn't happened for billions of years? Well, by looking at the center of our galaxy, the scientists behind this paper were able to identify such an event. They now believe that roughly around 1 billion years ago, there was a very major event that generated approximately 5% of all of the stars in the galaxy. That is a huge number. That's probably like 10 to maybe even 20 billion stars created all within a period of only a few million years. The study also suggests that this was probably one of the most energetic events in the history of our galaxy. It was literally like a sudden burst of explosion of activity that could have been visible from really far away and that may have also created a lot of formations around our galaxy that we're currently having trouble explaining, like for example the mysterious Fermi bubbles that I've talked about in one of the previous videos that are still kind of a mystery to us. They're there, they're definitely a sign of something really powerful that happened in the past, but we're just not entirely sure what this something was. But also by studying the center of our galaxy in a little bit more detail, the scientists behind this paper realized that overall the production of stars in the last 30 million years or so has actually increased a little bit. In other words, there are a little bit more stars that are being made today than there were about 100 million years ago when the dinosaurs were around. Now this number is not dramatic, but it is slightly higher than before. And the actual number is actually pretty low. In regards to the center of the galaxy, the number of stars made is equivalent to about half a mass of the Sun per year. So that's a size of a small star in general. Another major discovery from the study is that they realized that the so-called bar here, the galactic bar that our galaxy is famous for, may have not existed until recently. So this is something that we were not really sure about. As a matter of fact, even today scientists are still struggling to understand how this was formed. One of the best explanations involved basically Milky Way swallowing another galaxy, but it seems to have not existed until relatively recently. At least according to the study. But to me personally, one of the coolest things in the study was actually one of the ways that they discovered all of this, which is something you can see in this picture here. One of the ways they analyzed the light from these stars and also one of the ways they were able to see that there was a very major event happening about a billion years ago was by looking at the so-called CMB. Also known as the cosmic microwave background. This is of course the first light ever in the universe that was created when the universe became cool enough and also transparent enough for light to actually travel. So this allowed the scientists behind the study to pinpoint a part of the CMB where it kind of showed that there was a major event a billion years ago, and this is something that is kind of cool. And if you'd like to learn more about how they've discovered all of this, check out the paper in the description below. But I guess overall, it's the idea of having these really powerful events that happen once in a while in our galaxy that make this study and other studies very similar to it kind of interesting and somewhat intriguing. Because when you think about it, well, what if such an event happens today? Are we going to be in trouble? Is the life on Earth going to be struggling to survive because there's going to be too much energy around? Well, this is something we need to understand, and for us to understand this, we need to keep looking and we need to keep studying our galaxy and, of course, the universe out there. Hello, wonderful person, this is Anton, and today we're going to try to answer yet another mystery, this time related to the so-called OMG particle, but in more general terms about these really, really high energy particles that once in a while strike our planet Earth. So quite a long time ago, basically in 1991, we've discovered this unusual particle that was detected by a facility in Utah that was referred to as the OMG particle, mostly because of the amount of energy that it produced. Now, to give you kind of a visual representation, imagine taking a baseball and literally condensing it to the size of an atom, while of course maintaining the mass of that baseball as well. And then taking that baseball and launching it at a speed of about 100 kilometers per hour or about 60 miles per hour. So in other words, if we were to launch a baseball but it was atomic in size but yet have a mass of a baseball, this is how much energy is inside of these so-called particles. But if this baseball then struck your body, it would very likely pretty much go through your entire body and dislodge every single atom in your body that it passed through without any difficulty. And today we've detected about 72 of these particles as of 2019, and we refer to them as ultra high energy cosmic rays. So in other words, it's kind of like typical cosmic rays that we get every single second here on the planet, but usually about 20 to maybe even 50 million times more powerful. And so these are really powerful energetic events that we've been detecting around the planet, but their origin has always been a bit of a mystery because many of them seem to come from regions of space where there doesn't seem to be anything. And specifically, let me show you where one of these regions is from planet Earth. So here's our planet Earth, and if we were to look somewhere in here, okay, I'm going to cheat a little bit. I have to bring up the constellations just to see where I'm looking at. So the so-called Ursa Major, or the Big Dipper, seems to be the source of many of these unusually high energy events. So these really high energy particles are coming from somewhere in here. The only thing is that if we were to zoom in, there doesn't seem to be many things here that could produce these very high energy events. And so we're kind of confused about what's really happening here, because we always believe that these high energy particles should be really coming from some really extreme environments, like for example, middle of an ultra massive black hole, like the super famous M87 black hole that we've taken a picture of. And so these events should be energetic enough to produce something like an OMG particle. But this is unfortunately not what we're seeing, and we're detecting these events from regions of space that don't really have anything particularly powerful near them. And theoretically, the biggest source of these unusual particles should really be a radio galaxy. A galaxy that's similar to what you see on the screen, that's extremely powerful and is producing these very, very powerful astrophysical jets, even more powerful than M87. But it just so happens that only some of these particles were emanating from the region known to us that to have radio galaxies. The rest are coming from the darkness of space and the regions that are not really interesting. Which is why this new study that was recently released from Korean researchers might finally solve this mystery. It might finally explain what's really happening here, and it includes some really mind-blowing concepts. But first, let's talk about what they actually propose and what we need to know to understand this paper. And first of all, the scientists behind this paper are now absolutely certain that these ultra-high energy cosmic rays are coming from very known sources, like for example, M87 could be one of them, or any other radio galaxy somewhere out there in the Virgo cluster, basically the regions near us. So a lot of these well-known radio galaxies are probably the source for them. But how is it possible for these unusual rays to come from directions much, much farther away from these galaxies, from basically the source? And this is where the Korean scientists were able to identify how all of this is happening. So first of all, It's really important to understand that all of the galaxies in the cluster we're in are technically connected with what's known as galactic filaments. Now, these are really, really massive, really large structures, usually hundreds of millions of light years across, and it's technically also some of the biggest structures in the universe. It's a little bit difficult to see them, but you'll notice that here are some of these so-called galactic filaments. Basically, think of them as webs that cross the entire universe and form this beautiful formation. One of the better ways of visualizing all of this is using the Illustris simulation, and here, if I were to just enable the certain elements of the universe, you'll see how all of this forms the filaments across the entire universe. Now, all of this is simulated, but the idea and the actual observations do suggest that these filaments are everywhere. And you'll notice that these little spots here, these are the galaxies. And the filaments are more or less invisible in regular light, so this is what the regular light looks like. But as soon as we look at the gas distribution, or more specifically start analyzing the dark matter distribution, you'll notice that this is where these filaments become visible. So this is what they're made out of. They're made out of very large chunks of dark matter and have a lot of various gas in them. So we know that these filaments exist, and we have quite a lot of proof that they're out there and they connect galaxies, but we don't really know much else about them. And the scientists behind this paper use them to explain what's happening to these ultra-high energy particles. And according to these scientists, as these ultra-high energy particles leave the source, usually a radio galaxy, like for example even a galaxy like M87, some of them end up flying through these filaments, but despite their high energy, they're still just particles, and so many different things, specifically highly magnetic things, can change their direction at any time. And eventually, as they fly through these filaments and as they interact with various things in them, they might get diverted and end up coming closer and closer to our planet, and then eventually enter the atmosphere and collide with planet Earth. The main idea can be summarized by this image released by the scientists. We have the source of the ultra-high energy cosmic rays. The rays travel across the universe and may actually travel for a very, very long time, changing their direction many, many times, and they travel through these filaments until something scatters them back and they enter our galaxy and then cross our planet Earth. And so the scientists behind this paper believe that what we're detecting are the particles that were scattered by various events in these filaments, and thus we're looking at the interaction between ultra-high energy particles and something inside those filaments that caused them to change direction, which by itself actually raises a lot of questions as well. What could have possibly caused them to change direction? But that's of course not something they cover in this paper. Instead, what they do focus on is explaining what we're looking at and, of course, answer the question that drove scientists crazy for many years. And so it seems that it's these filaments that are responsible for carrying these ultra-high energy particles, and all of them probably came from objects like the by now very famous galaxy known as M87 with its ridiculously powerful black hole in the middle. But what's really crazy about all of this, due to the actual speed of these particles, and this is kind of where it blew my mind when I did the math behind this, if you were to travel along with this particle coming from M87 galaxy, and even if you were to travel, let's say, 100 million light years, just like they show in this illustration here, I think if you were to kind of add up the distance here, it would probably add up to about 100 million light years or so, until it reaches our own galaxy. If you were to imagine traveling along with this particle at these ridiculous speeds, very, very close to the speed of light, which honestly is very, very difficult to imagine, but the relativistic effects caused by traveling at such high speeds would mean that the particle itself, or I guess you traveling with this particle, would not feel like you traveled for 100 million years. So here we need to actually consider something known as the Lorentz factor. The Lorentz factor, about which you can learn on Wikipedia, refers to the dilation, essentially, time dilation or length dilation. And for many of these particles, the dilation effect is roughly around 300 billion. In other words, if you were to become this OMG particle, from the moment you left the region of M87 black hole until you hit planet Earth, for you, only about 2.7 hours have passed. So that is kind of mind-blowing. Even though for us here on Earth, it seems like this particle traveled for about 100 million years or so, for the particle itself, it only experienced 2.7 hours of life since its origin. or since the time it got kicked out from the M87 black hole. And honestly, I've personally found this kind of mind-blowing. So obviously, the closer to the speed of light you get, the more dilation you get, and so the slower time passes for you. And so by traveling at these ridiculously high speeds, we could technically explore the rest of the universe. But that's kind of beyond our capabilities right now. And it's sort of beyond the topic of what we're talking about here. So, in a nutshell, the scientists behind this paper discovered that it seems many of these high-energy particles that we always were wondering about did start around really powerful events, like various radio galaxies, and then traveled across the universe using these tunnel-like formations known as galactic filaments that are technically some of the biggest structures in the universe. And something caused them to change direction, come closer to planet Earth, and collide with it. And this of course means that we might have finally solved the mystery of the OMG particle and realize that all of them are coming from the same source, but are just getting to us in different ways. Hello wonderful person, this is Anton, and in this video we're going to be talking about a new study that very thoroughly managed to create the three-dimensional map of our galaxy. Not the entire galaxy, but the important parts. And this particular study was even able to confirm something we believed for a very long time, that our galaxy is not really flat. In other words, the typical representation of our galaxy, which is sort of like this, is somewhat incorrect. Our galaxy is, after all, quite warped. So this study, you can find in the description below, is from a Polish university, from University of Warsaw, and they've literally spent 6 years of their lives, their professional lives, to collect the data, to analyze it very thoroughly, and to then publish this paper. And honestly, just the amount of data they collected is already pretty impressive. They managed to analyze and thoroughly study 2400 different stars with a very, very specific unique identification. They're known as Seiffert variables. Now, a typical Seiffert variable looks something like this. As you can see, it sort of sparkles. In other words, it changes its luminosity. And here's a slightly more scientific version of this. It doesn't just change its luminosity, it actually even changes its size. The star itself manages to change its size because the gas on the inside cools down and then heats up, cools down and then heats up very regularly with a very predictable pattern based on the mass of the star itself. And sometimes this can be anywhere from several hours long to several months long, depending of course on the mass and the composition and the properties of the star. And we've managed to compile such a huge catalog of these stars that we know exactly what it means when one, for example, has a period of several hours. We know exactly what its luminosity should be, so by looking far away and seeing that the luminosity is not as bright, we can then determine the distance to that star very precisely. And this is why Seiffert variables are very often, and almost always, used as a kind of a, we call them distance candles. Basically, the very bright objects in space that we use to identify distances, usually in nearby galaxies or nearby space or even our own galaxy. And so, for example, if I look into this dark patch of space and I find a few Seiffert variables here, and then I'm able to see their vibrational patterns or their changes in luminosity and calculate the period of that luminosity, I'll be then able to very precisely establish the distance to this part of the galaxy. And today, this accuracy is usually within about 5%. So in other words, by looking at this star and by seeing it decrease in luminosity, increase in luminosity, and so on and so forth, I can usually establish the distance within about 5% of the actual value. And all of their data came from this beautiful telescope known as OGLI, which stands for Optical Gravitational Lensing Experiment. Now, basically, by using the data from this telescope, they've discovered those stars, they've established the distance, where they're located, and were then able to plot all of this on a kind of a map. And this is, by the way, what all of this looked like from Warsaw. One of the scientists took this beautiful picture showing the actual Seiffert variables they were able to observe as well. And then the map itself, when you work it out, looks something like this. And as you can see here, the actual shape of the galaxy is no longer as flat as we imagined. As a matter of fact, you can see how it sort of folds on this side and also folds a little bit on the other side. And these folds were very likely formed by various gravitational interactions with other galaxies, and specifically with the galaxies that Milky Way most likely then consumed to increase its own mass. Now, today we believe that these galaxies are still kind of out there somewhere and most likely are orbiting around our own galaxy, or at least their leftovers are. And we've actually been discovering a lot of these leftovers known as stellar streams in the last few years. These stellar streams are pretty much all over the place, and every year we discover new ones. So this is kind of like the new exciting part of research in astronomy, where we're trying to identify other stellar streams in a nearby vicinity and try to identify where they may have come from. But right now we don't really know what formed these unusual ripple-like formations. We just know that it's very likely from some really major interaction with other galaxies. Most importantly though, just like we expected before and just like we simulated before, and here's actually what the simulation might look like, the shape of the galaxy is not flat and seems to be somewhat rippled and somewhat warped. Now in this particular picture, what you're looking at is the simulation versus observation, so basically what we simulated it to be and then what we actually detected. Which is kind of to say that we expected it to be this, and now the theory has officially been proven by observational analysis and by looking directly at those stars. And most specifically, these particular detections allowed us to much more thoroughly, with a lot more detail, to see where the actual warping starts and also how it sort of progresses throughout other parts of the galaxy. Now the warp itself, as you can see, only starts at a distance of roughly around 25,000 light years away from the center, so it doesn't really affect the rest of the galaxy. Our sun is about 27,000 light years away from the center, so it's already kind of in the initial stages of this ripple. So whatever affected the galaxy initially, and whatever gave the galaxy these unusual formations, may have happened not so far away from our sun to begin with. And the other really interesting finding here, which can be actually better seen on the previous picture, and here it's the color that's important, the color here represents the age of the stars, and you'll notice that stars seem to come in chunks. Basically, you'll see the same color in one location, but not in the other location. And this also suggests to us that these Seiffert variables come in sort of large formations of similar age, which is a really important finding because this really indicates to us that the star formation in galaxies, or at least in our galaxy, doesn't happen constantly. It really happens in these bursts of star formation. It happens for a while, then it stops. It happens for a while again, then it stops again. It's something that we definitely need to confirm or try to study a little bit more, because this would indicate to us how galaxies grow and how they develop and how they evolve. And this particular finding really kind of confirms this burst evolution of galaxies. In other words, that galaxies kind of basically grow in spurts. They don't grow constantly. And to try to confirm this and to try to even extend this particular map and this study even further, the future studies from these scientists will focus on another type of very known stars known as RR Lyrae stars. Here's what the original RR Lyrae looks like, and these are also stars very similar to Seiffert variables that change their size and their actual temperature with time, with very predictable phases that can be used to determine distances. But the difference between this and Seiffert variables is that they also live much longer and they can be found much farther away in the galaxy, and it's very likely that we're going to be able to expand the map even more because of this. And I guess if it takes these scientists about 6 more years to come up with the part 2 of the study, well, we're gonna have to wait until 2025. Although hopefully it won't take as long. And by then, they'll definitely have a much better, more realistic, and more detailed representation of the galaxy. And hopefully someone will even make it into some kind of a simulation. But, you know, putting 2,400 stars on a galactic map with very precise positions is going to be pretty challenging. But I'm sure someone will do it, and then we'll talk about it in another video. Hello, wonderful person, this is Anton. And in this video, we're going to be talking about a new discovery in regards to galaxies known as quasars. So right now we're flying through the universe. Every single spot that you see is actually a really, really large and massive galaxy. And as you can see, some are brighter than the others. And in the middle right there, that's Milky Way. Now out there, we've discovered a type of a galaxy known as a quasar, which sort of stands for quasi-star, because back in the days when we just discovered them, they were these unusual star-looking objects that were emitting a lot of radio light, radio emissions. And scientists couldn't really explain it until they realized what they were looking at was actually something like this. It was a tremendously powerful black hole in the middle of the galaxy that was absorbing a large amount of mass and creating these tremendously powerful astrophysical jets that were kind of sort of pointed almost directly at us in this way, basically creating this really bright object. Now, since then, we've discovered a lot of quasars, but we also discovered a lot of mysteries in regards to them. And today we also know that some galaxies sometimes activate, they become active galactic nuclei galaxies, and eventually turn into quasars. But some galaxies may have never done it, or may become quasars later on. So today we see it as a kind of a transitionary stage. But most scientists today also believe that when a galaxy becomes a quasar, basically when it starts emitting all of this energy, it also emits what's known as galactic winds, which are these really powerful dust winds that strip the galaxy of all of the material that can be used to create new stars, and thus at the end of the quasar life, what is left is a galaxy that's unable to produce new stars. And in some sense, for the most part, we also believe that quasar is kind of like the end of life for the galaxy. And here's an image of one of the most famous and also one of the closest active galactic nuclei galaxies to us, known as Centaurus A. You can find a video about it above my head. So here what you're looking at is a composite image of the X-ray radiation coming from this galaxy, combined with the radio emissions. This is specifically from the central black hole, and this is actually why we call it a quasar or a quasi-radio star. And then obviously there is the optical emissions here. Combined together, it sort of looks like this. And you can even see all of the galactic wind that's emitted here by the super powerful energy coming from the central black hole. In one of the previous videos, I talked about how much mass is lost during such emissions, and an average quasar loses roughly around 200 masses of the sun per year, which is at least 100 times more mass loss than what our galaxy, the Milky Way, uses right now when trying to create new stars. In other words, the total mass loss that escapes the galaxy is way, way higher than the loss due to the creation of stars. And so we've always believed that quasars basically are like the end of life of galaxies. And following the quasar stage, a galaxy typically turns into this really quiet, really dim object with a somewhat bright blue star-like object, which is the black hole in the middle. And all of this ends up in the galaxy becoming really quiet and eventually sort of dying out. I mean, the galaxy doesn't actually just disappear, but it just cannot really produce new stars. But the new research that you can also find in the description below talks about this new type of a quasar that we didn't really expect existed, and it seems that we were maybe a little bit wrong about this whole concept to begin with. Using this really powerful telescope known as XMM Newton, the scientists from Kansas analyzed various quasars out there, and they've discovered that it seems that at least 10% of these quasars actually maintain their ability to create stars even afterwards and end up in a kind of a stage that they refer to as a cold quasar. So even though originally we believed that the only way for a quasar galaxy to start production of stars is to experience a collision like you see on the screen, it seems that these scientists discovered that that's not necessarily true. It seems that we just didn't really understand what quasars are. They're not the end of the life of a galaxy. They actually refer to this as a kind of a retirement party. Basically, it's a transition stage when a galaxy turns into this new stage known as cold quasar, and at least 10% of the observed galaxies did that. And during this stage, it can still actually create quite a lot of stars. And what's interesting is that the explanation for why we haven't seen more of these cold quasar galaxies before is because we think that it only lasts for about 10 million years. And after this, the galaxy transitions into its next stage and becomes something else. And although some of these quasars will end up as these shapeless elliptical galaxies that have a lot of really old stars but don't produce new stars almost at all, some of them end up as something very different. And although we're not entirely sure if all of the galaxies go through this stage, what we're certain of is that a lot of them do end up in this cold quasar stage, and actually, despite losing a tremendous amount of mass, are still quite able to produce new stars afterwards. This also may suggest that one day, our own galaxy, the Milky Way, may also go through this stage, if it still hasn't, that is,
and will end up losing a lot of mass, will end up turning into what may be a cold quasar with a relatively large, somewhat interesting black hole region that will resemble this really, really interesting blue star, even though technically that's a black hole that's emitting all of this light. And then following this, it will end up as maybe an elliptical galaxy that is still able to produce stars. Now, we're not entirely sure when or if at all it's going to happen, but we do know that following the galactic collision with the Andromeda galaxy that's going to happen in the next 4 billion years, it's quite possible that our galaxy will experience this active galactic nuclear stage because of the actual collision. And following that, it might turn into an elliptical galaxy. So the Milky Way galaxy has a really high chance of turning into one of these cold quasars as well. Oh, and by the way, if you're wondering why this is such an interesting blue object and why it looks like a blue star, it's actually because, well, this is a typical black hole that produces a lot of energy, so it does look blue, but the reason we actually see it as a blue star is because due to the galactic winds, it was able to blow away all of this dust that usually hides the black hole in the middle and sort of emptied the space around it, creating this really beautiful object in the middle. So in other words, it's actually the power of galactic winds that results in the galaxy losing all of this mass that creates these beautiful objects that we now refer to as cold quasars. So anyway, that's kind of all we know about these particular objects for now. It's still a relatively recent discovery, and it still doesn't really explain a lot of other things about quasars, and more specifically doesn't really tell us about whether our own galaxy is going to become that. But what is important here is that it just helps us understand the universe a little bit more. We always thought that, you know, quasars are basically the end of line for galaxies, but now we realize that we were wrong about it. It seems that it's just a transition stage. We still don't really know when exactly galaxies do officially die and stop producing stars, but we know that it slowly is happening to every galaxy around the universe. Our galaxy used to produce a lot more stars, and the star formation actually peaked roughly around 10 billion years ago. Since then, all galaxies lost their ability to produce as many stars, and they only regained this ability during the galactic collision. Now, one day, maybe all of these galaxies will actually stop producing stars altogether. And that's officially going to become known as the death of the universe. When this is going to happen, we don't really know yet, but we definitely know that our galaxy and our universe is not increasing the speed of star production. In other words, you could almost call it, I guess, the slow death of the universe, mostly because less and less stars are produced pretty much every year around the universe, and because it's not really getting any brighter, it's actually dimming all across. But nevertheless, our galaxy and also our universe still has a few billion years left in it, possibly even longer, and well, I guess it would be interesting to find out when exactly will it actually stop producing new stars.
Hello wonderful person, this is Anton, and in this video we're going to be talking about something mysterious that seems to be happening right at the center of our galaxy where the supermassive black hole Sagittarius A star is located. So imagine you're looking at Sagittarius A star and you're trying to investigate it, and then suddenly, for some unknown reason, the brightness of the Sagittarius A star goes up by about 75 times. In other words, it becomes ridiculously bright. So bright, as a matter of fact, that it's about 32 times as luminous or as bright as our sun. But this doesn't last, and then suddenly it goes down again after only a few hours. So this is what the scientists behind this paper discovered only a few days ago from when I'm making this video. They were looking at our black hole and suddenly, for no apparent reason, it became really bright very, very quickly, beating all previous records, being the brightest it's ever been since we started observing it roughly around 20 years ago. So we can kind of imagine what's maybe happening here, but we don't really know why. And the easiest explanation here is, of course, that something in the central region of the galaxy came too close to Sagittarius A star and got absorbed by it, generating all of this energy through the increase in the luminosity in the accretion disk. But as you may know, we are actively looking at this region pretty much every day, and we always observe at what's happening in the central region. And nothing seems to have happened in the last year or so that would generate such a tremendous amount of energy.
However, over a year ago, the so-called S2 star did come relatively close to the supermassive black hole, as you can see right here, and it does so every 16 years. At the same time, there were at least two so-called clouds that also approached the black hole relatively close, and as you can see, may have caused this emission that we now observe. However, our simulations suggest that this is probably what the cloud looks like right now, and if the matter did fall into the black hole, it did so without really alerting us to this happening. And if this matter came from the S2 star that you see right here that orbits the black hole every 16 years, well, in this case, it seems to have taken its sweet time to get into the black hole. Well, let's try to see if it's even possible. At its closest approach to the black hole, which is right there in the distance, the matter from S2 star was roughly around 100 astronomical units away, 100 times the distance of Earth to the Sun. So I decided to basically take a random star here and place it at 100 AU, 100 astronomical units, away from the Sagittarius A star that's right there. And let's see if it takes roughly around 1 year to reach this black hole. So right now it says 3 days. We're going to basically run the simulation, and if it takes roughly around 1 year, then I guess maybe the biggest culprit was the matter from the star itself. And here, because of the gravitational acceleration from the black hole, the star starts moving pretty fast, pretty quick. And all of this matter is actually already moving at like 68,000 kilometers per second. Now, only a day later, it's basically already on the edges of the black hole. Now, this might be a very extreme version of the simulation, but it does show you, first of all, how powerful the black hole is. But it also shows you that it's kind of something that should have happened much earlier. This matter should have fallen into the black hole a lot quicker than over a year that would have taken this object to fall into the black hole. And so it's possible that the matter that fell into the black hole came from somewhere else, not from the S2 star, and also not from the G1 and G2 clouds that came relatively close to the black hole and essentially fell apart, as you see right here. But it just so happens that literally a day after the release of initial paper, another team, completely separate team, using a completely different telescope, was able to observe something else coming from exactly the same region. And they saw not just the illumination, but also very powerful X-ray flares that were most likely caused by something once again falling into the black hole. These flares were also ridiculously bright and very powerful, and suggested that something major is happening around Sagittarius A star, and we don't really know what. There was even a suggestion that maybe we just don't really understand how the accretion disks work. Maybe this is something that's pretty common, but we just didn't really calculate it precisely. So, nevertheless though, it doesn't change the fact that our black hole is strangely becoming more bright and more active. Something very active, very, very powerful and very energetic is happening here, and we are not entirely sure what's causing it. Now, it's possible that it's an object that fell into the black hole that we just didn't see before. Maybe even something smaller, like a tiny moon or a very large asteroid that got disintegrated and fell into the black hole. But because it's been happening for a few months now, we think that it's just something that we need to study in a little bit more detail. Now, because of the actual flares and the power involved, and due to the distances involved here, which is roughly around 23,000 light years away from us, we really shouldn't be concerned about this. This black hole is still really, really far away from us, so we have nothing to worry about. But if this is something that is only at the beginning of something much larger, in that case, we definitely need to study it and see if it causes us any danger. Because obviously the last thing we want is for something as powerful as an astrophysical jet to suddenly point at our planet. Now, it's probably not going to happen, but nevertheless, this is why we study these things, because we want to understand them and be able to predict when something dangerous does happen. And what's really interesting is that back in 2018, when the scientists were observing the passage of S2 star, as you see right here, we actually expected some kind of a, basically a fireworks show. We expected flares and explosions and potentially a lot of different energy produced that we would be observing, but ironically, nothing happened back then. So maybe, just maybe, this is just a delayed reaction to this. Maybe this is something that is supposed to happen, but we just didn't know that it's going to take a while for all of this to start happening.
At the same time, something similar was expected from the G1 and G2 clouds, and also not much happened back then either. And so if this simulation is correct, as you see here, in the next few years we should be observing a lot of these flares, because G2 cloud may have released a lot of materials that will actually fall into the black hole and create this energy that we'll be able to observe from planet Earth and study in more detail. But for now, as of today, we don't really know what's happening, we just know that it happened. We also know that we shouldn't really worry yet, but it's something that we need to understand so we don't have to worry in the future. And at the same time, it gives us a much better reason to try to zoom in here once again, take a really, really detailed picture of what's happening here, and to of course try to understand not only how black holes work, but also how the accretion disk influences everything around it and what it really does around the black hole. The best simulations right now are still just simulations. We're still not entirely sure if this is what the accretion disk even looks like. So once we understand all of this, we'll be able to explain why the black hole suddenly increased in luminosity, and if these flares are going to happen again, and of course when they happen in the future. Hello wonderful person, this is Anton, and in this video we're going to be talking about pretty brilliant research. Now, a few decades ago, Stephen Hawking, the brilliant scientist who pretty much taught us everything we know about black holes based on his theories, predicted that, well, dark matter might be black holes. As a matter of fact, he didn't really believe that dark matter was some kind of unusual substance or some kind of a strange particle. He believed that dark matter was, at least for the most part, really, really tiny primordial black holes. Basically, black holes just like you see on the screen right here, but the ones that were created right after the Big Bang, or possibly even during the Big Bang, or maybe, just maybe, they were the reason for the Big Bang. In other words, he believed that our universe was covered in these really tiny, atom-sized or even smaller black holes that were still quite massive and provided significant enough mass to the entire galaxy to kind of hold it together. Just to give you a slightly better representation here, so here's Earth, here's Moon. If you were to turn the Moon into a black hole by condensing it into a tiny, tiny, tiny particle, which is theoretically possible, and we actually believe that these micro black holes do exist, then you would get what Stephen Hawking would call just a piece of dark matter that is holding our galaxy together. And we can actually try this using Universe Sandbox by literally taking the Moon and decreasing its radius while holding its mass constant, which would of course increase its density to the point where the light can no longer escape it. And this is when it turns into a black hole. Now for this to happen, well, if I were to do it this way, it would be a pretty long video. It would be a very long video, because it's going to take forever or a very long time for the Moon to get to the small enough size. Nobody has time for that, so we're just going to cheat a little bit and change the Moon manually. And so here we go. It's so tiny that we can no longer see it. But essentially, the Moon is now a proton-sized black hole, a micro black hole, or, as Stephen Hawking referred to them, primordial micro black holes. And so he believed for the longest time that they were everywhere, we just couldn't really see them because they're so, so tiny. But the Japanese scientists, led by Masahiro Takada from University of Japan, figured this out. They actually found a way to, well, technically prove Stephen Hawking wrong. So it's not really one of those videos where we confirm something. It's a video where we actually disprove something. We disprove the idea that Stephen Hawking had, and in other words, this particular research unfortunately disproves the theory of micro black holes or mini black holes as dark matter. And let me explain to you how they did it and why it's actually super, super brilliant. So first of all, they've only used one single telescope for the whole study, and this is the Subaru telescope in Hawaii, and it has something known as Hyper Supreme Cam, HSC. It's essentially a super detailed and very, very sensitive camera. And to try to figure out if Stephen Hawking is correct or wrong, all they decided to do is stare at a single spot into the Andromeda galaxy, and they decided to take a lot of pictures with a relatively short exposure, because they were looking for just one little thing. They were looking for this, the phenomenon known as microlensing. Now, if you don't really know what this is, let me quickly explain it to you. Microlensing is an effect that we've known about for a really, really long time, and essentially, it's a general relativity effect where anything that has mass will bend light around it, and if it does it in the right way, it can actually create a kind of a lensing effect, increasing the luminosity of things behind this object. Here's a relatively simple visual that shows you what's happening here. So here's our telescope, or whatever camera you're using to observe things. Here's an object with mass, doesn't matter what kind of mass, but in this case we're going to be looking at black holes of one single massive moon. And here is a star behind this. If this object passes in front of a star, it lenses the light from the star in such a way that you actually see an increase in luminosity. And this is quite visible. As a matter of fact, we've detected planets this way, we've detected a lot of things this way. Microlensing is such a powerful effect that it's used for a lot of things in astronomy. And so these scientists thought about it and they realized, well, listen, micro black holes will create lensing effects as well. They'll create a lot of microlensing effects, but because they're so tiny, they're only proton sized, this particular effect will be very, very fast. Instead of having a long sort of maybe a few seconds effect, it will be almost like a flash. And they realized, so, okay, if we look into the night skies, and in this particular study, the night skies are the Andromeda galaxy, if we look at the entire galaxy, considering that it probably has a lot of dark matter in there, and if this dark matter is, well, black holes, we're going to see a lot of these micro flashes everywhere because there are so many stars out there. There are trillions of stars, at least a few of them probably will pass in front of a micro black hole that represents dark matter, and so we're going to see these flashes if we take fast enough pictures with fast exposure. And so that's pretty much what they did. They took several pictures, they literally looked at the Andromeda galaxy for a few hours, and in those 7 hours of looking at the Andromeda galaxy, they took about 200 different pictures, and interestingly, they only found one single microflash. They expected at least 1,000. Because of the amount of stars and the amount of dark matter, they expected a lot. There was only one. Now, this one, however, is a mystery in itself, because maybe this also was the first ever detection of a micro black hole. The fact that they saw this microflash needs another investigation and follow-up studies. But the fact that they didn't see the thousands of expected flashes suggests that Stephen Hawking was unfortunately wrong. It's very likely that black holes are not dark matter. It's very likely that the micro black holes that he suggested do not create the effects we see that we refer to as dark matter. So in that sense, brilliant study, very interesting discovery of that one microflash, but unfortunately for late Stephen Hawking, this is not good news. This is definitely something that the proponents of black holes as dark matter theory would probably not want to hear about. But that one microflash, whatever caused it, needs to be investigated again. So we need to have follow-up studies using very similar techniques and see what we discover in other galaxies, and then find out what exactly caused this unusual microflash. There is, however, a little side note about this particular study. This particular analysis did not include black holes that could be even smaller in mass, like, for example, an asteroid mass black hole. These could also exist, but unfortunately they would be even more difficult to detect. So for the most part, the moon-sized black holes are definitely out of the picture. The larger black holes probably as well. But if those micro black holes are even smaller in size and in mass, they could still maybe be the dark matter, but very, very unlikely at this point. And what all of this suggests, of course, is that we now are going to start looking for what really caused this one single detection. This by itself may suggest that micro black holes are definitely out there. This may also suggest that a lot of things we know about the universe and the creation of the universe may still be a little bit mysterious to us because we don't understand how such tiny black holes could have even formed. If they were born from the beginning of the universe, what exactly caused them? How did they come to be? And why is it that we've only found one? However, once again, this could be just a data problem, so maybe it's just a mistake, maybe it's an error. Once we have more follow-ups, we'll come back and talk a little bit more about this. For now though, I'm going to keep my mind wide open and hope that this is it. We've finally discovered the smallest black hole ever. at least for now. Hello, wonderful person, this is Anton, and you're looking at the vicinity of the Milky Way galaxy, the so-called galactic neighborhood. In this video, we're going to be talking about the two nearby galaxies that are actually some of the most well-known galaxies to us, because for the longest time ever, the humanity was actually using these two galaxies to navigate the oceans. They're known as the Magellanic Clouds. Let's talk about the Large Magellanic Cloud and its sibling Small Magellanic Cloud, and most importantly, discover, is there anything connecting them? So both the Small and the Large Magellanic Clouds are essentially the satellite galaxies of the Milky Way. Milky Way itself is located right here, and you can kind of see that these two smaller galaxies essentially sort of orbit around the Milky Way. But in this simulation, and I guess in our sort of common understanding of galaxies, we don't really think anything connects them. We don't really ever think about what's happening between these galaxies. But in the last few years, and more specifically, I guess in the last decade or so, we've actually discovered quite a lot of things that make you realize that pretty much everything in the universe is actually connected. For example, a few years ago, the scientists realized when they were looking at the night skies, there was something unusual going on with very large amounts of gas connecting both the Large Magellanic Cloud with the Milky Way and then also the Small Magellanic Cloud with the Milky Way. The actual stream of gas was also moving really fast. The speeds here were up to about 400 kilometers per second. And just to give you a comparison, our solar system is only moving at around 230 kilometers per second. So this was fast moving gas that was either approaching us or moving away from us. And what this gas suggested is basically a connection. It's a connection between the Milky Way and both of the other galaxies. And what's not surprising is that this gas, for the most part, seems to be moving into the Milky Way. In other words, think of it as a large straw. Straw extending from the Milky Way into the other two galaxies, where our own galaxy seems to be kind of seeping some of the material from them. So it's kind of like sucking all of this matter out of the smaller two galaxies into itself. Which is really not surprising because our galaxy is more massive, but I guess we just never really imagined that it would be something that we'll detect with our telescopes. So the so-called Magellanic Stream was officially discovered using Hubble telescope only in 2013. And it really makes us realize how essentially our galaxy is slowly absorbing everything around itself. I'm sure other bigger galaxies did the same, but what the Milky Way galaxy represents is essentially a collection of various matter that was slowly absorbed over billions of years. And it's of course something that hasn't really stopped and is still actively going on even today. But what's kind of not really that surprising is that most of this gas seems to be from the Small Magellanic Cloud, from the smaller galaxy. In other words, it's the smallest galaxy that's been, I guess you can call it, bullied the most. But having looked around for some other signs, scientists also discovered other unusual connections. This time not just between the Milky Way, but between these two galaxies as well. And they named this the Magellanic Bridge. So the Large Magellanic Cloud and the Small Magellanic Clouds are also connected with each other. And here it's even more interesting because this is not just a gas connection. This is actually a connection involving stars and even tiny little oases of star formations, which is something we've never really expected to see. So there's literally tiny little star constellations in between of the galaxies, which unfortunately don't really exist in any of the simulations I have, but imagine as you travel between these two galaxies, you suddenly come upon an actual star constellation with active stars, with planets, with everything you expect from a typical star system. And of course there's a lot of gas here, but what's more, it also seems to have a relatively unusual and somewhat powerful magnetic field. The actual bridge itself seems to be magnetized, and it's something we couldn't really explain. It's something that we've detected only a few years ago, but even today we don't really know why there is a magnetic field in this bridge. But unlike the connection between Large Magellanic Cloud and the Milky Way, this connection here is not just gas, it's literally a stellar connection. I mean, hypothetically, if we're talking about an interstellar travel, you could definitely use these stars to kind of hop between them to finally make your way into the other galaxy. And there are actually a lot of stars here. Luckily for us, there are also the so-called sethi variable stars, which are stars that are typically known for increasing and decreasing their luminosity very periodically, and we've always used these stars to identify distances to certain objects. And because we've discovered so many different Cepheid variables in between the large and small Magellanic clouds in the so-called Magellanic Bridge, we'll now be able to very accurately and very precisely map it using basically a 3D map. We can totally make this into an actual 3D map of the entire connection between these two galaxies. Now, it might take us years to finally finish this, but it's definitely possible because of all of the stars we've discovered here. But personally, I find it fascinating that in between these galaxies, somewhere out there, there is actually a region that we currently refer to as OGLE Island, which was only discovered in 2014 by the Polish astronomers, and it's literally like an oasis of stars that are all together, and it seems to be slowly moving toward the Large Magellanic Cloud, which of course suggests that all of this matter and all of these stars are slowly being stolen by the Large Magellanic Cloud from the Small Magellanic Cloud. In other words, all of this suggests to us that this beautiful galaxy, Small Magellanic Cloud, is the one that's being bullied both by the Large Magellanic Cloud and by the Milky Way. In other words, it's slowly losing its mass because it's sort of being sucked away from it or taken away from it by both of the partner galaxies. So honestly, all three of these galaxies are really fascinating. The connection between them really kind of suggests that, like I said before, everything in the universe, every single galaxy, is very likely connected. There's probably at least a gas connection or possibly even a star connection, and there's very likely such connection between every major galaxy in the universe as well. And today the scientists definitely think that such connection exists between the Andromeda and the Milky Way, and it's very likely we're going to discover it one day as well. And there are definitely a lot of hints suggesting that such connection exists because there are at least 600 different stars we've discovered between the Andromeda and the Milky Way, in basically a sort of a web-like formation. So these galactic filaments, as we call them, are definitely real, and we today think that pretty much everything is interconnected. If you actually would like to see how all of these cosmic connections look like, you can use a simulation like, for example, this right here, the Illustrious Project, which simulates universe as we believe it is. And here you can definitely see these very beautiful formations that we call the cosmic web, forming between every single galaxy, even tiny small galaxies like the Large and Small Magellanic Clouds that are connected to the Milky Way. But all of this story will actually end in about 2.5 billion years, when both of these galaxies will very likely get absorbed by the Milky Way. This will also happen before the collision with the Andromeda and before the collision with other galaxy, the Triangulum Galaxy, but at some point all of this will become one. The cosmic webs will disappear, but other cosmic webs will form with other galaxies. Hello, wonderful person, this is Anton, and in this video we're going to be talking about these unusual galaxies known as super spirals. Galaxies that we've only discovered very recently, about which we kind of know very little. But today, we've discovered something new. So, there are a lot of different types of galaxies out there. There are, of course, irregular galaxies that don't really have a specific shape. There are also large elliptical galaxies, some of which are the biggest galaxies in the universe. Specifically, the one I'm thinking about is IC1101. And generally, you can kind of find a few more galaxy types that are out there. But there's one type of a galaxy that was very recently discovered, only in 2016, that we never knew existed, simply because they're super, super rare. These are called super spiral galaxies. Just like the spiral galaxy the Milky Way, our own galaxy, just like the spiral galaxy Andromeda. But of course, super. In other words, more massive, larger, and more of everything. In other words, imagine if this is our own Milky Way, a typical super spiral galaxy would have about 10 times more mass, and also be about 10 times bigger as well, while producing way, way more light in general, and overall being a lot more of everything that you expect a galaxy to be. We've only discovered super spiral galaxies back in 2016, and it actually made the news back then, and since then we've discovered only about 100 of them. Now, 100 might sound like a lot of galaxies, but when you think about it, there are at least a few trillion visible galaxies out there. In other words, every single dot right there is a galaxy. There are trillions of these. Trillions. That's 1 followed by 12 zeros.
And of all of these galaxies, we've only discovered about 100 of these super spiral galaxies that you see on the screen here. So in that sense, they do seem to present a bit of a mystery, and they do seem to be kind of rare. And so in the study that I'm going to be posting in the description below, we've discovered something really unusual about them. And specifically, we discovered that unlike other galaxies out there that roughly have a somewhat similar galaxy rotation curve, which defines the speed of stars orbiting around the center of the galaxy, this is actually an animation you can find on Wikipedia that shows you that in a typical galaxy that you see on the right, stars tend to orbit a little bit faster than they should. We expect them to orbit slower, like in the galaxy on the left. This is how the idea of dark matter was originally proposed by Vera Rubin back in the 70s. But anyway, we're not really talking about dark matter, although it is going to come up at some point. What we've discovered about these super spiral galaxies is that the rotation curve for them is actually a lot higher than a typical galaxy as well. In other words, all of these stars in these galaxies orbit at least a double, but in most cases even triple the speed. So in other words, if we were to take a look at our galaxy and then try to discover our sun, which I think is right there in the middle somewhere, the orbital speed around the galaxy is roughly around 220 kilometers per second. This is something that's actually similar to stars across the galactic arm here, and it's also similar to other typical spiral galaxies as well. Usually the speed doesn't really differ that much. But for each of these super spirals, the velocity is at least 500 kilometers per second, and in many cases, it seems to be closer to about 600, 570 for this one right here, for example. This is actually what the images of these galaxies look like coming out of Hubble, and what's interesting about all of these galaxies is that they don't really possess that many stars to have such a high velocity. In other words, what all of this suggests is that pretty much all of these galaxies have a tremendous amount of dark matter on the inside. Now, this means two things. One of those things is that this, of course, once again shows us that dark matter is responsible for allowing these galaxies to maintain stars without having them fall apart, even though the stars move really, really fast on the inside. But at the same time, and this is really important, it once again proves the existence of dark matter. There are many different ideas that have been proposed to try to explain away dark matter. For example, the most famous one is this right here. It's known as MOND, or Modified Newton Dynamics. And it just basically tries to change the physics a little bit to allow us to explain the universe without dark matter. But every once in a while we discover something, for example, a strange galaxy somewhere out there, or in this case, 100 such galaxies, that do once again show us that dark matter seems to be real. It really is holding these galaxies together. There's so far no better explanation for what we're seeing, except for this mysterious dark matter. And so for each of these super spiral galaxies we've investigated so far, for the most part, the only reasonable explanation is that their galactic halos are tremendously large. The size of these halos are equivalent to a typical dark matter halo in an actual galactic cluster and not just a typical galaxy. So this is really interesting because what this suggests is that these tremendously large galaxies are formed by having several galaxies combined together, and then all of this dark matter kind of forms a bubble around them. And so it's as if very large galaxies combine into one and became this tremendous giant known as a super spiral. But all of this also suggests one major thing. This could be the future of the Milky Way. Today we know that the Milky Way is eventually, in the next 3 billion years, going to absorb all of its neighboring galaxies. The smaller galaxies you see in the distance there, those are the large and small Magellanic clouds. And at some point, it's also going to swallow the Triangulum galaxy, which is right there in the distance, and the other galaxy you see next to it, that's the Andromeda. All three galaxies, Triangulum, Andromeda, and of course the Milky Way, are eventually going to become one. They're eventually going to collide into one super galaxy. We think it's going to happen around 4 billion years from now, and it's going to be an event that's most likely going to end up creating one major galaxy in the region. And the way that we believe galaxies evolve today, we also think that at some point it is going to become a spiral, basically a super spiral. So, in other words, it's very likely that at some point in the future, our Milky Way galaxy and the Andromeda and the Triangulum all together will look something like this.
as one of these super spiral galaxies you see on the screen. So we're technically looking into the future sometime in the next 5 to possibly 10 billion years from now. Now, it's not going to be as massive or as bright as any of these galaxies because we just don't have as much mass combined even with Andromeda and the Triangulum galaxy, but it is going to be a large enough galaxy to be noticeable and to have influence compared to some of the other nearby galaxies within around 30 million to maybe 50 million light years away from us. And so it's possible that we've just kind of witnessed the future of our own galaxy sometime in the next few billion years. But even though this study does present us with this possibility of seeing the future, I think a much more important discovery was in regards to dark matter. Because one of the dark matter halos discovered in one of these galaxies was absolutely ridiculously large. The estimates suggest that it was about 40 trillion masses of the Sun. That's literally around 1,000 times more massive than all of the stars in the Milky Way combined. That is a huge halo. At the same time, they also realized that in these unusual galaxies, the star formation seems to be much lower than you would expect it to be. And the scientists behind this paper suggested that maybe this is also something that's caused by dark matter. Maybe dark matter actually prevents star formations in these types of galaxies. Their explanation involved the gas speed and potentially the motion of the gas in general that could be moving too fast for stars to form. And all of this is probably caused by the tremendous power, gravitational power, of all of this dark matter in these galaxies. So in other words, because of the amount of dark matter present in these galaxies, the star formation is actually much slower than it should be. And hopefully one day we'll be able to either confirm or disprove this, but for now it's a pretty cool discovery. Hello wonderful person, this is Anton, and in this video we're going to be moving away from our own galaxy, the Milky Way, and talking about a recent discovery and a recent analysis of a very large and very unusual structure pretty close to our own home, the Milky Way, although much farther away than most people can imagine, known as the local void. For the first time ever, the scientists were able to very accurately map this unusual region, and today we'll talk about what they discovered. So to start trying to imagine the actual sizes of, I guess, objects in this particular study, we need to really zoom out of our own galaxy. We're talking about structures that are tremendously big in size, millions of light years across. Now, just to give you an idea, here is the Andromeda galaxy, and that tiny spot right there is the Milky Way galaxy. The distance between them is approximately 2.5 million light years. It is pretty far away, but the distances we're going to be talking about are roughly around 100 times that. So we're going to really need to zoom out of here to try to imagine all of this. And so what we know about the universe today is that it's not really that uniform. And if you were to look at the map of the universe as we know it today, it would look very kind of unusual and very clumpy. Here is, for example, just a part of it, and you can see that this huge Virgo supercluster, that's where we are located, is basically like a clump of galaxies together, but in between these galaxies there are a lot of different voids, with the most famous one being this one right here, Buta's void. These voids are, for the most part, sort of more or less devoid of matter, or at least regular matter, and different galaxies. We don't really know exactly how they form and why they form, but we know that there's a lot of them out there, and usually you only find one or two or maybe maximum 6 or 7 galaxies in them, with most of the other stuff being kind of empty or at least looking empty. It might be full of dark matter, but we don't think there's really anything there. But although Buta's void is probably the most famous one, there is one much closer to us and obviously a lot more interesting because it's literally on our doorsteps. So here is the Milky Way right here, this is the local group of galaxies, and there's this really large void, as you can see, basically empty space, known as the local void. It doesn't have a better name because we never really bothered to come up with one. And we've only discovered this back in 1987 by looking at the night skies and realizing there was a lot of empty space. But the thing is, it's kind of difficult to study this particular area, mostly because it's hidden by the very large amount of dust coming from the Milky Way, because it's basically behind our galactic center. And so it basically took a long time for the scientists to finally map it and figure out how large and how tremendously mind-blowing it is. The so-called local void is now officially measured at several hundred million light years,
and it also seems to be expanding pretty fast. As a matter of fact, as the universe expands, so is the local void. And that's kind of the main premise of this paper, is that they were able to map it quite thoroughly, but also realize that it's expanding really fast, up to about 600 kilometers per second. And what's interesting is that having created this 3D model, you can see that the local void is completely empty and everything is moving away from it, including our own galaxy that's moving away from the local void at approximately 270 kilometers per second. So it's growing in size, it's becoming more empty than it even used to be, and everything is sort of moving in the direction of various gravitational attractors around the universe. As a matter of fact, in our own local region, most things are moving toward the so-called great attractor that is forming the so-called center of our supercluster. And if you were to kind of combine all of the things together that are moving toward this great attractor, creating a kind of a superstructure, you would get something that would resemble this. Now, these lines represent the motion here, and I've talked about this previously, we even have a name for it now, it's known as Laniakea. You can check out the video about this somewhere above my head. But being able to so accurately track everything and also map out everything is a really, really tremendous achievement. For this particular study, the scientists used roughly around 18,000 galaxies and the data from the Gaia telescope that allowed them to basically create this beautiful 3D interaction of galaxies and their gravitational attractors. But even though we have this image now and we know where things are moving, this doesn't really help us explain what's really happening in these unusual voids and why things are moving away from them while being attracted to something else in the universe. And if you were wondering about the distances involved here, so this is roughly around 150 million light years, which is about 60 times the distance between Milky Way and the Andromeda Galaxy. So it's pretty far away. And so even though it is a pretty dramatic distance here, what's super unusual about all of this is that this is literally on our doorsteps. It's very, very close to where Milky Way is located, and it's as if we were standing on a kind of an edge of a cliff looking into the abyss of nothingness, or basically empty space. Now, it's not entirely empty. Don't get me wrong, there's still stuff in there. There's at least three well-known galaxies inside of this unusual void, with the largest galaxy being this right here. This is NGC 7077. A lot of the galaxies that we have detected in these voids are usually kind of dwarf-ish, they're smaller in size, but as you can see, around this galaxy, there's very, very, very little. It's sort of stuck there by itself in this unusual void that's expanding, and this also implies that at some point this galaxy is going to be completely alone, because as the universe expands, all of the other galaxies are going to move beyond its visible horizon. But despite all of the questions that this study may have created, it possibly answered some of the questions as well, and specifically one question in regards to the unusual observation when it comes to measuring the rate of expansion of the universe. I've talked about this in one of the previous videos, but there's an unusual discovery that suggests that the local galaxies are expanding a little bit faster than they should. In other words, the actual expansion of the universe near us is faster by roughly around, I think it's 4 to 7 kilometers per second, than what we've observed in distant parts of the universe. It did create a bit of a, I guess, confusion, and also some people suggested that maybe our measurement of the age of the universe is wrong, but in reality, what this paper tries to explain is that it's just that the actual composition of the local group makes it so that the amount of dark energy here, and also the local void itself, and also the attractors near us, kind of force the actual fabric of space near us to expand a little bit faster than it should. Now, this is still not a fact, and it's just kind of a suggestion based on the observation that they have here, but based on what they see, it seems that because of this emptiness of space next to us and a relatively large attractor not so far away, the interaction between these sort of causes the nearby space close to where we are to expand and to stretch out a little bit faster than it should be stretching out to begin with. In other words, the Hubble constant that was calculated very recently using the nearby local group galaxies is higher because the local void is causing the universe near us to expand a little bit faster. And it's a very interesting discovery. It's actually kind of controversial in a sense, but if they're correct, it definitely means that we have to study this local void in a little bit more detail and discover what's really hiding there. Is there some sort of an unusual deposit of huge amounts of dark energy that's kind of forcing us to expand faster? Nevertheless though, because it's sort of hidden by this large deposit of dust in the Milky Way, it makes it somewhat difficult for us to really study this in detail. The only reason we're able to even see all of this motion is because we looked at the galaxies in the vicinity, 18,000 of them specifically, and we were able to see how they're moving across the universe. And so in short, the presence of this unusual lack of matter and this huge void next to us, and also the presence of an attractor not so far away from us, creates these unusual conditions in the local group of galaxies. And this is something that we might want to study a little bit more because it would allow us to sort of explain the shape and the evolution of the universe and also help us understand various effects of dark matter, dark energy, and other unusual effects around the universe that could, of course, one day lead to us developing some sort of a really awesome technology that we can't even imagine just yet. But for now, that's all I wanted to mention in this particular video. Check out the actual study in the description below. And this paper honestly has some of the best I've ever seen maps of nearby local group and also the actual clusters near us. There are some really, really awesome 3D images of nearby systems, and at the same time, it also kind of helps you realize how tiny and insignificant we really are when it comes to the actual universe. Hello, wonderful person, this is Anton, and in this video we're going to be talking about the motion of our solar system across the galaxy. It's a topic that many other YouTubers have done as well, and it's a topic that I've also covered on the channel previously, but this time we're going to do this a little bit more realistically in terms of the actual inclinations of the Sun, the Earth, and so on. In other words, we're going to try to recreate the motion of our entire solar system relatively realistically using Universe Sandbox. Now, you might have seen a lot of other YouTube videos where the motion of the Sun is presented across the galaxy as a kind of a simulation that you see on the screen right here, although I'm yet to see at least one of these videos where the actual inclinations and the actual positioning of the planets and, of course, the star is accurate. However, this animation is relatively accurate, although the angles are not really presented. So let's try to recreate this using the newly updated Universe Sandbox, where the galaxies do look quite interesting and quite beautiful. So first of all, we need to start with the distance of where the Sun is located compared to the central region of the galaxy, and of course compared to the Sagittarius A star black hole right there in the middle. And the common analysis suggests that the distance here is roughly around 25,500 light years away from the black hole. This number might change in the future, and it has changed in the past, but right now we believe it's around 25,500. So we're going to place our Sun somewhere in one of these arms at a distance of just over 25,500 light years. And so here it is, at a distance of 25,500 light years, Sagittarius A star black hole is right there in the middle, and this is the so-called Milky Way. But the problem here is that the Sun actually doesn't spin in the same plane as the galaxy. As a matter of fact, when the Sun spins, the north pole of the Sun points this way, and it forms an angle of roughly around 60 degrees with the so-called galactic plane. In other words, we're going to have to take our Sun and make it rotate by roughly around 60.2 degrees. And so right here you can kind of see how the Sun spins almost on the side as it travels in this direction across the galaxy. So if we were to zoom out, this is sort of what it looks like on the larger scale of things. And the Sun is going this way, while its north pole, also known as the north ecliptic pole, is pointing that way. And the angle right here between the galactic plane and the ecliptic plane, or the plane of the Sun, is roughly around 60.2 degrees. And so technically, to see the planet spinning now, we have to kind of spin our head 60 degrees, but this is not it. This is actually not the end of the complexity, because the planets also don't spin on the same plane as the plane of the solar rotation. In other words, there's still a little bit of a difference between the rotation of the Sun and also the plane where the planets are. So now we're going to add a little bit of complexity to this. And luckily for us, planet Earth is the easiest planet to start with here because it actually lies in the same plane of orbit as the so-called ecliptic plane. In other words, the angle between the orbit of Earth and the galactic plane is roughly around 60.2 degrees as well. However, as Earth orbits the Sun, it orbits on this so-called ecliptic plane, and luckily for us, it is almost 0 degrees. But the rotational axis of Earth is shifted, as you can see, by roughly around 23.4 degrees, and this is why we get seasons. So it does get a little bit more complicated because now we have to obviously rotate our Earth a little bit to give it that 23.4 degree rotation of axes. And so now we have three so-called norths. We have the ecliptic north, which is formed by the Sun and the solar plane itself. We have the galactic north, which is formed by the galaxy and it's up, as you would call it here in this simulation. And lastly, we have the celestial north, which is formed by Earth and it's pointed slightly differently as well. The angle between the celestial north or Earth north and the galactic north is roughly around 63 degrees. The angle between Earth and the Sun is 23 degrees, and lastly, the angle between the Sun and the galactic plane is about 60 degrees. Here's a brief summary of all of this, and yeah, it does get kind of complicated. This is probably why most of those YouTube simulations weren't really able to simulate all of this together. Now, this is just for Earth, right? We have seven other planets. And if I did all seven planets, this video would probably be about an hour long. Maybe one day we'll do that, but not today. Today we're just going to cheat and place all of them. By placing all of the eight planets, starting with the terrestrial planets, in a relatively similar plane to Earth. We're not going to bother with the actual spin right now because it's not really that important. We just want to see how all of this moves across the galaxy. Later on, maybe we'll do this a little bit more realistically. So this is what we're going to do. So here we need to try to align everything with what we have. This is kind of what all of this will look like. So Jupiter now is in the same plane as other planets and is going to be moving this way just as it does in real life. Let's do the same for the remaining three planets to make this beautiful solar system inclined as it should be with approximately 60 degree inclination to the galactic plane and with all of the objects moving as they should be moving. So now we're going to run the simulation. Also, let's enable trails here so you can actually see what all of these planets will be doing as they move around the Sun. So this right here is a lot more realistic in terms of the inclinations, in terms of the actual positioning of the planets, and in terms of the actual motions around the galaxy. So in reality, this is what all of this looks like, with the Sun obviously spinning on its side with a 60 degree inclination. Now, all of this is actually kind of fun to try to recreate in Universe Sandbox, and all of this looks super amazing with the new update. There is, however, one problem with the new update, and this is something that Universe Sandbox is not going to be able to resolve anytime soon because the dark matter is no longer here. And if we look at the time it takes for the Sun to orbit a single time around the galaxy, basically the so-called galactic year, it is unfortunately going to be a little bit off. Here it says it's about 85 million years. In reality, it's close to about 220 million years. And until we can actually find a way to simulate galaxies using both dark matter and regular matter, we're not going to be able to create anything super realistic. But for now, it's not really that important. This is what the important part is. This is what all of this looks like as the solar system moves around the galaxy and as it flies through our beautiful Milky Way. So in one of the future videos, we'll try to create this even more realistically, possibly even adding the actual axial tilts to every planet, and maybe even adding moons. But honestly, this is going to really slow down my computer dramatically, and I honestly feel like this is already quite enough. So this is the real solar system as it moves through the galaxy, and I'm going to save this as one of the mods that you can download from Universe Sandbox using Steam with the name Real Motion of the Solar System Through the Galaxy. It's going to be shared on Steam so you can download it and try this for yourself and maybe even improve on it or add more details. So if you have Universe Sandbox, feel free to download it and try this for yourself. Hello wonderful person, this is Anton, and in this video we're going to be talking about the Milky Way galaxy, our home, and how apparently it turns out our galaxy is a bit of a thief. Well, at least galactic thief. It steals stuff from other galaxies. So in a nutshell, what this study here that you can also find in the description below proposes and talks about is that over time, our galaxy, the Milky Way, may have sort of unofficially borrowed and kept
a lot of smaller galaxies from our satellites. Now, it might not make sense yet, but let me show you what's going on here in terms of the actual structure. So, our Milky Way galaxy has quite a lot of neighbors. The two larger ones you can kind of see right there in the background. Here is the Large Magellanic Cloud, which you can easily see in the night skies if you're in the right location. And here is the Small Magellanic Cloud. But there are a lot more in this region. Here are just some of the larger ones, but if you were to try to find all of them, you would discover a list of over 50 different smaller galaxies that kind of exist around the Milky Way, and some of them we only recently discovered. But the main point of the study is that it seems a lot of these smaller galaxies used to orbit other galaxies, like for example Large Magellanic Cloud and Small Magellanic Cloud. In other words, they were the satellites of a satellite. And one of the main discoveries here was that Large Magellanic Cloud had a lot of them, because it seems to possess enough dark matter to be able to hold on to quite a lot of various objects. But turns out Milky Way is just so much better because it's obviously more massive. So it kind of took those galaxies away, it stole them, and it's now officially absorbing them, adding their total mass to the mass of our galaxy. And although this doesn't really come as a surprise that, you know, our galaxy is massive enough to absorb other galaxies, this does create a very unusual era for our galaxy, which suggests that we are now in the middle of the largest galactic merger in the history of our galaxy. With the approximate suggestion of total mass being about one third of the mass of the Milky Way being constantly added into our galaxy. All of this coming from these satellites that used to orbit other galaxies, or even the galaxies like Large Magellanic Cloud that you see right here. Another important discovery coming from the study is that the assumption or the estimate for the satellite galaxies that we had previously may have been very, very small. It may have been incorrect. Here's actually one such galaxy. It seems that there are a lot more of these small galaxies out there in the vicinity of the Milky Way than we believed. And what's even more interesting is that one of the suggestions here was that we may have to redefine what we think of as a galaxy. Because the scientists behind this paper identified certain locations that seem to have possibly a black hole, possibly a lot of dark matter orbiting around it, very few stars or even no stars, but there was a lot of gas. Would this still constitute a galaxy? Does a galaxy have to have visual properties? Does it have to have stars for us to consider it to be an actual galaxy? And this is really important, because over the years we've identified several really faint galaxies. Here's actually one, here's another one, and here's a third one. All three galaxies here are really faint, they have very, very few stars, but their total mass is really big. And all of this suggests that they have a central black hole, they have a lot of dark matter orbiting around it, they also have a lot of gas, but unfortunately not enough stars for us to easily see it. So in that sense, it's a very unusual object. Right now we don't really classify them as anything special, we simply refer to them as diffuse dwarf galaxies. But this new study suggests that these are really common in the vicinity, and some of them possess enough dark matter and enough mass to make them legitimate galaxies as well, but some of them have no stars whatsoever. So in that sense, we might need to one day redefine what a galaxy is, or at least make it a little bit more clear what exactly these things are that orbit around the Milky Way that don't really have any stars. Another major confirmation was, of course, that a lot of these smaller galaxies, like this one right here, this is the Carina Dwarf Spherical Galaxy, were definitely part of the Large Magellanic Cloud and were the so-called stolen satellites. They've identified at least seven such smaller galaxies, all of them are now part of the Milky Way, and are also slowly being absorbed by the Milky Way, eventually kind of turning it all into one mega galaxy. And interestingly, one of the other suggestions is that there might be even smaller satellites around these satellites. So you could have a satellite of a satellite of a satellite. But because of the large structure like the Milky Way, eventually all of them will probably get absorbed as well. Which once again reinforces the fact that, well, we're in the middle of a very large galactic collision, we just can't seem to really easily see it because it's either a lot of dark matter colliding, or it's much smaller objects like these dwarf galaxies that we've only identified a few years ago. As a matter of fact, last year we've discovered quite a lot of them, and we'll probably discover a lot more this year as well. But what's interesting is that all of this may have only started about a billion years ago. So up until then, it's very likely that a lot of these dwarf galaxies were still satellites of, for example, Large Magellanic Cloud. So the Milky Way has become the so-called thief galaxy only relatively recently. And we think that in the next 3 billion years or so, it will very likely absorb everything around it. It's going to become a lot more massive, at least 30% more massive, when all of these dwarf galaxies are absorbed and become one with our own. And the other main suggestion coming out of this study is that we definitely need to investigate how many more these unusual small galaxies are out there. And it's very likely that with new telescopes, we'll be able to discover a lot more of these unusual galaxies, some of which were definitely very difficult to see up until now. And the more of these unusual dwarf galaxies we discover, the more confirmation we'll get that dark matter seems to be a real thing. There is really no other theoretical explanation for how these galaxies are able to exist, or how this, even though it's really difficult to see, can even stay together. Without dark matter, it would simply fly apart or not even be a shape at all. But it will definitely take a few more years before we can discover more about this unusual dark matter, and before we can identify other similar galaxies nearby. And that's simply because most of them were, as of today, discovered completely by accident. And even though the Milky Way galaxy will probably end this collision and this absorption of other galaxies within about 2 billion years from now, it will then start another one, first with the Triangulum galaxy, and finally with the extremely large Andromeda galaxy. And eventually, all of this will of course create one massive galaxy. In one of the previous videos, I mentioned that this might be some kind of a super spiral galaxy, very similar to the ones we've only discovered a few years ago. Hello, wonderful person, this is Anton, and today we're going to be answering the question, what types of galaxies could potentially produce intelligent life similar to us? Okay, maybe we're not really that intelligent just yet, but, you know, we do have hope. So my first experience in astronomy research was actually related to the field known as astrobiology. But back then, we didn't really talk about galaxies, we didn't even really talk about exoplanets because we haven't really found that many. We've mostly talked about various signs coming from our own solar system, specifically related to life on Mars. And most of my research time was spent digging through rocks, looking inside those rocks, and trying to discover if these unusual signs that we've found inside them were formed by life or by something completely natural that was not related to life. And, just a spoiler, we didn't find life. We didn't find any signs of life, but we did find something that resembled life, but was produced naturally by chemical reactions in space. But I didn't really end up in the research field and instead pursued my career in education. But eventually I came back to my roots and started unofficially studying astrobiology yet again. Which is why when I discovered this new paper, I got really excited. So this new paper that you can find in the description below talks about the idea of galactic habitability. In other words, studying various galaxies for their ability to not just maintain life, but to potentially create a long-term life for billions of years. And all of this, of course, relates to the so-called rare Earth hypothesis, or in a sense to Fermi paradox. In other words, why is it that Earth is so unique? And why is it that we're having trouble discovering life outside of our planet? Why is it that we're not seeing aliens and some kind of at least microscopic alien life everywhere? So all of this relates to this field of astrobiology, and this particular paper kind of takes it to the next step by identifying types of various galaxies that could potentially create life. Now, first of all, a few years ago, some scientists proposed the idea of having what's known as a galactic habitable zone. In other words, they believe that only certain parts of the galaxy, and specifically the parts of the galaxy that are not too active, that don't have too many supernova, and also that have what's known as population 1 stars, or basically the younger stars, can create life. And it sort of relates to two major things, two major concepts. The first concept is stability, because obviously if we find ourselves in the part of the galaxy that is not really stable, that has a lot of the supernova that you see right there in the back, it's very likely that no life can potentially survive for longer than a few million years, and thus will not really be able to advance and become intelligent and possibly become complex enough to explore the rest of the galaxy. So stability is really important, and the parts of our own galaxy where we are right now are stable. There's pretty much nothing going on here. The supernovae are really rare, and for these reasons, the life here on our planet was able to evolve and survive for billions of years, even though we had some occasional what's known as extinction events. But anyway, so that's one primary reason why we think galaxies have this habitable zone. The other thing that we actually need for life to evolve are the materials. In other words, the actual molecules, specific molecules, that can evolve something like us. Now, we have a lot of elements inside our bodies, with roughly around 65% of everything being oxygen and about 18% of everything being carbon. Those two elements are what we refer to as non-metals. In astronomy or in anything related to space studies, metals are elements that are not hydrogen and not helium, and those elements need some kind of a very special event like supernova to produce them. In other words, younger stars that have not received those elements, that are basically just hydrogen and helium, would not be able to produce life, or at least complex life that we see on our planet. Hydrogen and helium alone would very unlikely be able to produce complexity, or the complexity needed for life, that is. So things like oxygen, things like carbon, all of these require at least one supernova, but preferably several supernova, in order for all of these molecules to be created. But following these very powerful events like supernova, all of these elements have to find themselves in a relatively quiet place somewhere on the outskirts of the galaxy, and also have a relatively quiet star like our sun. So all of this can create life that will then evolve over time, over billions of years, into possibly something that's similar to us. And so the scientists behind this paper decided to try to find or actually simulate a lot of various galaxies, thousands of galaxies, to try to discover which galaxies would potentially be able to create complex life similar to us, and thus be the best targets for future studies in trying to discover extraterrestrial intelligence. And in order to simulate all of this, they've used this brilliant project known as the Illustris Project. This is something you can also find in the description below, and they even have this beautiful simulation of everything that's going on here. And the way it works is it uses modern physics to simulate a kind of a cube that's about a few million light years across, and inside of this cube is literally a piece of an actual universe simulated as we'd imagine it today. So right now you're seeing light from the stars. I can also change this to show you things like dark matter. So this is what we believe dark matter in this part of the universe looks like. You can also take a look at distribution of gas, which is what you're seeing on the screen right now. Here is an image of the temperature of this gas. And most importantly for this study, here is what the gas metallicity looks like. And so by using the data from the simulation, the scientists behind this paper were able to simulate the metallicity of various galaxies and also look at other parameters inside of those galaxies to try to point out which of these galaxies would be best for finding life and best for essentially maintaining life. And it turns out that, well, just like we previously thought, galaxies similar to the Milky Way, which are essentially the spiral galaxies, very similar to our own Milky Way, and especially galaxies that don't produce as many stars anymore, would be some of the best places to discover, well, potentially discover, extraterrestrial life. There's actually another study I recently read that analyzed nearby galaxies, approximately a million or so of them, and they found out that within those galaxies, there were roughly around 170 or so Milky Way-like galaxies that are very similar to what we have here. And if you were to compare this to the rest of the universe, it means that there are roughly around 172 million Milky Way-like galaxies out there. But what about other types of galaxies? Well, in this study, they discovered that these are actually not the best galaxies for extraterrestrial life. These are not the most stable and also not the most likely to have life similar to us. And it seems that instead, it's the dwarf galaxies, very similar to the nearby Large Magellanic Cloud that I'm currently trying to find in the night skies, that are the best sources of potential extraterrestrial life. Now, one of the main reasons why the scientists behind this paper believe that these dwarf galaxies are actually very, very likely to have similar conditions to what we have here in our own solar system is that, first of all, a lot of these galaxies are more or less quiet. They don't produce as many stars, they don't have as many supernovae, and they do have a lot more regions of their entire galaxy that are basically friendly to developing life. But on the other hand, they also are very high in metallicity compared to other galaxies. In other words, there are a lot more stars here that have elements that are not hydrogen and helium, and many of these stars have a potential to create complex extraterrestrial life. But when it comes to metallicity, these scientists also mention that you have to be really careful, because high metallicity does not necessarily mean that life is guaranteed. As a matter of fact, they point out that certain objects we've discovered in our own galaxy have high metallicity, but also have a chance to develop these really, really massive Jupiter or Jupiter-like objects that, as they travel across their star systems, might potentially end up destroying the other planets, like objects that would maybe become planet Earth. So, not all systems are perfect. Not all systems with high metallicity would develop Earth-like planets. But nevertheless, the metallicity is really important, and it just so happens that these dwarf galaxies, similar to Large Magellanic Cloud, may be the better places for us to discover life. They point out a few other galaxies nearby, like for example, Andromeda has a very similar satellite around it known as M32 or Messier 32. Here's what this galaxy looks like. And they believe that it's quite possible that this galaxy also has a higher chance of having extraterrestrial life. Here is another one called Fornax, a spherical dwarf galaxy. This is actually very close to the Milky Way. And all of these have very, very high metallicity, or higher than usual metallicity, very low activity, and thus produce objects very similar to Earth with complex molecules on the surface, and kickstart some sort of a life event. And so in the end, what all of this means is that not obviously all galaxies are perfect places for us to look for life, but there are certain galaxies that we should maybe focus on in our attempt to discover extraterrestrial intelligence. So what the scientists behind this paper suggest is that maybe the SETI studies, the future SETI discoveries, can try to focus on a few of these galaxies and really spend more time looking at them, such as, for example, the nearby Large Magellanic Cloud, to try to discover signals coming from those regions of space, instead of trying to focus on everything. Because maybe they're correct, maybe not all galaxies can maintain life for longer than a few million years. And so, for example, the very famous M87 galaxy, where we were able to take a picture of a black hole in the middle, is not really a particularly good home for life, mostly because of the extreme power produced by the black hole and the so-called active galactic nuclei. Here, the energy produced by the central region in the galaxy is so ridiculously high that it would very likely not give any kind of life a chance to stay stable for billions of years, like here in the Milky Way in the region where we are. So galaxies like M87 is sort of out. We really maybe shouldn't focus on this galaxy at all, because chances of discovering something complex here are currently pretty low. And so instead, focusing on these dwarf galaxies might be a better strategy. But anyway, for now that's kind of all we know. And just to summarize, it seems that these dwarf galaxies are some of the friendlier galaxies for establishing life and maintaining it for billions of years. But most importantly, this study and also the brilliant Illustrious project that you can find in the description below will allow us with time to discover new galaxies and new places in the universe where we might potentially discover some sort of extraterrestrial life. On that note, check out the Illustrious project in the description, but also check out the paper I mentioned that talks specifically about various galaxies they believe might have extraterrestrial life. On that note, thank you for watching, subscribe if you still haven't, and if you'd like to learn more about space and sciences, share this with someone who loves learning about sciences, and possibly come back tomorrow to learn something you may have not known before. But also maybe support this channel on Patreon, because it does actually help me quite a lot. I'll see you tomorrow, space out, and as always, bye-bye.